The next item of business is a debate on motion 4287 in the name of Jackson Carlaw on the new BBC Scotland digital channel. May I ask those who wish to speak to press the request to speak buttons? Can I tell you we're already pushed for time, short of time, so we'll be quite strict. And I call on Jackson Carlaw to speak to and move the motion. Up to 8 minutes, please, Mr. Carlaw.
Presiding Officer, may I firstly move the motion in my name. Last week, Lord Hall, the Director General of the BBC, successfully achieved a feat no Chancellor or Finance Secretary has managed in the last 25 years of budgets. He produced a surprise and he managed to keep it a secret. And it caught some politicians, commentators and broadcasters flat-footed. It certainly bamboozled a Mr. John Nicholson, who postures as the SNP's culture spokesman, albeit I understand he is an MP at Westminster. In the hours before the announcement, he rushed in where angels feared to tread and boomed that this multi-million pound investment by the BBC, quote, demonstrated an extraordinary lack of ambition and commitment to Scotland. Now, so for the sake of clarification, I urge Fiona Hyslop in her speech this afternoon to confirm that notwithstanding Mr. Nicholson's ambitions, she remains the SNP culture spokesman. That culture is indeed devolved to this Parliament, and I want to assure her that this party will fight, fight and fight again to prevent the seizing of control of Scottish culture by the SNP at Westminster, the most grievous assault on our powers in 20 years of devolution. Now, the surprise at the heart of Lord Hall's announcement, of course, was the announcement of a new BBC Scotland digital channel from the autumn of 2018. However, the announcement also laid to rest the long-running discussion regarding a Scottish Six. Last September, at the Edinburgh Policy Conference on the TV market in Scotland, I made clear that Scottish Conservatives were not opposed to such a broadcast in principle, but that it faced various difficult challenges. Firstly, the not inconsiderable fact that the public, in all published expressions of opinion, declared that they were content with the current national UK broadcast at Six, with Reporting Scotland following on afterwards. Both these programmes are popular with viewers. Indeed, Reporting Scotland is the most consistently watched Scottish news programme, even if some like me might prefer the And Finally slot to commence a little later than 25 to 7. Secondly, the horrendous experience of experimenting with the national news at 6 a generation ago with the programme 60 Minutes, an unmitigated failure with which Lord Hall was himself associated, which did huge reputational damage to the BBC, from which it took some time to recover, a risk we simply cannot afford at the present time. Thirdly, the fact that a Scottish Six may well have reduced the coverage of Scottish news in the rest of the UK at the 6 o'clock news bulletin, which would inevitably have been detrimental to our interests. And finally, and this has been represented to me by many of my elderly constituents, the fact that for many, the national news at Six is their principal source of daily broadcasting news. Like all sensible people, they are tucked up in their beds with a good book by 10 o'clock. While nationalists saw the whole issue through the prism or even the prison of evangelical arguments about independence, we and others judged it against the challenges it would have presented and speak on behalf of the vast majority of viewers across Scotland who fully support and welcome the decision of Lord Hall to maintain a national UK news broadcast at 6 p.m. There will be no envelope with a second decision. Presiding Officer, I should say at this point that we support and we accept the Labour amendment to our motion in the name of Lewis Macdonald. And while I agree with the sentiment of the SNP amendment, what it removes from the motion plays entirely to its neuroses and prejudices in a small-minded and churlish manner, and I regret it, as will the overwhelming majority of viewers who support the sentiments the amendment seeks to dismiss. In any event, given that Labour amendment encapsulates the sentiments of Fiona Hyslop's, perhaps even yet she will feel able to withdraw. Presiding Officer, the new BBC Scotland digital channel represents a huge commitment to an opportunity for Scotland. We all welcome the new employment opportunities created, in particular the 80 new journalist posts arising from the central programme in the new channel schedule. An international news hour from Scotland at 9 o'clock, when the largest prospective viewer audience is available. The new channel will broadcast from 7 to midnight daily, with a programme schedule of which 60%, some 1,000 hours, will be new commissions, and with £19 million of new money. Together with the existing BBC Two opt-out funding, some £30 million, all of which will be invested in programme, an equivalent sum to the current BBC Four budget, which produces just 750 hours of new programming. We expect the BBC to make a success of BBC to Scotland and to ensure that its funding model is both robust and appropriate, and this will be a judgment reached over the next few years. Presiding Officer, all this is without doubt genuinely exciting for broadcasting in Scotland and a huge opportunity for the creative film and television arts in our country. However, our motion today argues that it is also the moment for the Scottish Government and all of us to ask if we are currently structured to make a success of this opportunity and to ask if we currently have adequate and competitive studio capacity. There is little point in creating opportunities for new drama and comedy if we are unable to film them due to an absence of studio capacity, and then to our dismay find that the new broadcasting hours in Scotland are being filmed with programmes made elsewhere. Now, I'm afraid we are simply not yet a thoroughbred at the races. We may well enjoy a wonderfully diverse and talented independent film and television sector in Scotland, and many award-winning documentaries and popular household-named television programmes are produced by them. However, the access to the networks has been problematic, and they have worked in the face of a historical indifference to the television industry in general from Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland with regard to television, while also acting together with a raft of uncoordinated involvement from other agencies. Now, while Creative Scotland is now engaging, the reality is that Northern Ireland Screen is regarded as a model of government, enterprise and creative arts cooperation, and it's stealing a march in Scotland. I will, yes.
Fiona Hislop.
Is the member aware that in Northern Ireland, the public spend for Northern Ireland Film Commission by the Northern Irish is 10.6 million for 14-15, and the latest figures for Scotland were 24 million?
Not
Jackson Carlaw.
The Cabinet Secretary misses the point. It's the coordination between the various agencies which is leading to an opportunity for the independent sector to be fully involved in the opportunities that are made available by the extra screen hours that are there. The recent history we have to overcome in Scotland is one of so-called lift and shift era, where productions travel to Scotland on a sort of busman's holiday, bringing all its needs with it, but leaving lock, stock and barrel when the production finished. It didn't leave the creative footprint in Scotland, which nurtured and fulfilled the talent opportunities that we need to see the government take a lead on developing. So we see, for example, the new International Next movie in the Marvel's Avengers series, film and location here in Scotland, a notable achievement. On location, yes, but the lack of studio and production facilities means that a movie with a stellar budget, all of which could have been spent in Scotland, will instead see the interior film and production work completed in Atlanta. Now, I know there are planning applications pending. I hear rumours, too, of Scottish ministers working on announcements for their party conference ahead of Parliament. And what's important is both that we create the right studio capacity, not try to force the industry into empty government property currently seeking a purpose, but that we greenlight urgently proposals which will transform our opportunity in our creative arts with it. Presiding Officer, this is an exciting time for broadcasting in Scotland, a once-in-a-generational opportunity for film and television creative arts. It must serve and advantage all parts of Scotland and radio too. However, it presents a challenge of its own to the BBC to now make good on their promise, on the Scottish Government to create a competitive investment model, on government and industry together to identify and develop world-leading studio capacity in Scotland to create a Scottish Hollywood to complement Scotland's Hollywood.
I now call on Fiona Hislop to speak to and move Amendment 4287.3 up to 6 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name and I welcome this opportunity to contribute to the debate after the announcement from the BBC last week. As this chamber is aware, the Scottish Government negotiated a role during the development of the new charter and influenced the shape of its content to include support for Scotland's creative economy. Last week's announcements demonstrate that our role in the charter is having an impact. I've met Tony Hall, Director General of the BBC, four times in the last year regarding the case for Scotland and the need to reflect, represent and serve the nations and regions. And I welcome Scotland's new channel as it responds to calls we've made for some time, as long ago as the Broadcasting Commission for Scotland and more recently in our widely supported policy position on the BBC Charter. And while the increased investment in both journalism and wider production in Scotland is overdue, this is very positive. And it's welcome that the Conservatives now approve, because when the First Minister called for a separate channel at the Edinburgh Television Festival as recently as 2015, Liz Smith of the Conservatives said that the First Minister was out of touch and that millions of pounds of licence fee funds shouldn't be diverted to pay for it. So this road to Damascus moment is heartening, particularly when you consider it alongside the spectacular U-turn from Jackson Carlaw, who in 2013 called the licence fee to be abolished and for the BBC to make its own way, i.e. be privatised. Presiding Officer, in 2009, the Scottish Broadcasting Commission estimated that the similar channel to what's being proposed would cost around £75 million a year. That's more than double the £30 million that's been announced. Now, when I raised this with Lord Hall last week, he said that the new channel can draw on the wider resources of the BBC, and he expects this channel to be fresh and different. He also stressed that this channel is wholly the entity of BBC Scotland, and so it's critical that this channel has commissioning and editorial independence, and that it's properly resourced. No Scottish Six is disappointing, but I expect the Scottish Nine to deliver. Quality journalism is key to delivering the best for Scotland, and the BBC's investment in 80 new journalism jobs is great news. And it confirms what we knew all along, that Scotland has the talent and skills to produce an hour-long news and current affairs programme covering issues from home and abroad. Now, that's 18 months away, and between now and the launch of the channel, and indeed after, the BBC as a whole must invest in quality news programming and deliver relevant content to the people of Scotland as we move through Brexit, the triggering of Article 50, and beyond. But of course, we must keep things in perspective. Last week's announcements means by 2019-20, the BBC will spend 68% of the licence fee raised in Scotland. But this is still less than the 74% in Northern Ireland and the 95% in Wales spent in 2015-16, and only 5% up from 2013 in Scotland. Lord Hall was reluctant to agree to the Screen Leadership Group's recommendation for the BBC to spend 100%, arguing that the coherence of the BBC would be threatened. I disagree. The BBC must put Scotland on an equal footing with other devolved nations. Only last week, I was interviewed by the Danish broadcasting company. Denmark, with a population of 5.7 million, has six channels and quality news and, as we know very well, drama. But we must seize these opportunities that are presented with us from the announcement last week if we are to deliver on our wider ambitions for Screen. And I'm quite happy to keep the challenges that are set out in the original motion in what we are amending, so nothing in our amendment should cause the Conservatives any difficulty. Spend on Screen in Scotland is increasing. In 2015, we saw record levels of film and TV production spend of more than £52 million, and that's more than double that of 2007. The Scottish Government and its bodies are investing more than ever, £24 million, as I said, in 2014-15. And on top of that, we now have the new Production Growth Fund that was launched in 2015, and that's a £3 million fund that stimulates growth in production by providing incentives for major productions to come to Scotland. We've seen The Wife shooting in Scotland with Glenn Close and Churchill starring Brian Cox, as well as encouraging Scottish producers such as Brian Coffey to anchor their productions here. We are also establishing a dedicated Screen unit to reinvigorate the structural relationship between Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, which I understand is what the motion is asking for. And we are making progress on the studio and studio production space. The Ward Park Studios expansion is in train with the additional stages, and we'll see a world-class film and TV and studio facility there. But I must reiterate that we're not procuring a film studio. It must be private sector led. And we're continuing to develop our Screen infrastructure to deliver on a range of options, including purpose-built facilities, but also full-time conversions such as Ward Park and build spaces like the Pyramids and Palamas in Leith. And of course, the Pentlands proposal for a mixed-use development, including a film studio, energy centre and hotel, is sensitive and complex and is due for decision shortly. There is more to cover than perhaps 6 minutes certainly can allow, but I must emphasise in closing that the role of this government and this parliament in our scrutiny collectively, our debates and our negotiation have been instrumental in making progress with the BBC. But this is only the start, which is why on that consensual basis, our amendment keeps the meaning of the original motion in that I agree with it. I hope that Parliament can continue to work together and achieve more and further success for the screen industries in Scotland.
I call on Lewis MacDonald to speak to and move Amendment 4287.4. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr. MacDonald.
Thank you very much. Public service broadcasting has seldom been more important than at this time of change when journalistic integrity is under attack from many different directions here and around the world. We need the institutions of a free society more than ever. Public service broadcasters need to be unafraid of those in power, to be willing to ask the hard questions and to be free to do their jobs. And that puts an obligation on politicians too. In debating the BBC, our starting point should be that no party and no government should tell a public service broadcaster what to say or how to say it. We should seek instead to build a consensus that protects journalistic freedoms. What the BBC offered last week was the basis for such a consensus, and it is disappointing that it has not been wholly welcomed accordingly. For too long, we have endured a sterile debate about whether to replace the 6 o'clock news and reporting Scotland with a Scottish Six or to keep the status quo. That argument became a proxy for the independence debate. Tony Hall has cut through all that by proposing a new channel with its own 9 o'clock news, allowing viewers to choose whether to watch an hour-long national and international news programme on BBC Scotland or to stick with half an hour from London and half an hour from Glasgow on BBC One. Those who have made the case for a Scottish perspective on world news should welcome the BBC's proposals on its merits rather than respond to it in terms of the wider constitutional debate. An hour-long programme at peak viewing time with access to BBC correspondents around the world and no direct competition on the BBC or anywhere else offers a choice viewers have not had before. The case for a Scottish Six has therefore fallen, not because it lacked merit, but because the BBC has come up with something better. The challenge now is to move on from the old arguments, get behind the new channel and make it work. That is what our amendment seeks to do today. 80 new journalist posts in Scotland is good news, especially at a time when newspaper journalism is under pressure. They can help refresh the whole media and creative sector, so long as new investment is made and new jobs are created right across Scotland and not just at Pacific Quay. Donalda McKinnon, director of BBC Scotland, committed at the Culture Committee last week to strengthen production centres beyond Glasgow. Ken Macquarie, director of Nations and Regions, promised that this investment will be spread across the whole of Scotland, the whole of the nation and all of its regions. Those commitments build on an earlier promise of BBC funding to support 20 local reporters and other people's news outlets across Scotland. And our amendment seeks to build on all of those commitments by calling for new investment, not just in the new channel, but across news, radio, TV, factual content and online, and for that investment to be distributed equitably across Scotland. Existing production centres already make many excellent programmes, as Mr. Macquarie acknowledged with reference to Aberdeen. BBC studios from Shetland to the borders can say the same, and many of Scotland's independent production companies are also based a long way from Pacific Quay. So none of that must be put at risk, and programme content must also reflect the whole country, the nation and all of its regions, rather than simply Scotland as seen from the central belt. BBC Alapa is another key part of that. Supporting Indigenous languages is the job of public service broadcasters, all public service broadcasters, not just of the BBC. The BBC's partner, MG Alapa, aspires to increase original content to 10 hours a week. The additional funding confirmed last week is welcome. It should see an increase from the current 4.2 hours to 7.2 hours a week. That is good progress, particularly on Gaelic weekend news, but halfway there also means more still to do, certainly.
Kate Forbes.
Thank you very much to the member for taking that intervention. And it was just to commend BBC Alapa for the work that they've done over the last few years. We talk about the Scottish Six. They've been offering the Scottish Eight for the last few years, which provides excellent news coverage in Scotland.
Lewis MacDonald.
Indeed, and a Scottish Eight in Gaelic complemented by a Scottish Nine in English will be indeed progress in the right direction. Final point that we raise here is that viewers should be able to find public service channels via electronic programme guides. That's particularly important for Alapa. But it will matter for the new BBC Scotland channel too. Ofcom has a duty to ensure that public service channels are easy to find by ensuring that they have prominent places on those guides. There is an opportunity to extend that remit to reflect changing technologies through the Digital Economy Bill at Westminster. And I hope all parties here can agree that that opportunity should not be missed. In all these respects, we are able to help ensure that the new channel can be a success. And on that basis, I move the amendment in my name.
We now move to the open debate. Very strict 4-minute speeches, please. Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted that the Scottish Conservatives have brought this debate to Parliament today, which takes the opportunity to discuss this new and exciting opportunity for Scottish programming. It is the biggest investment in broadcast content in Scotland in over 20 years. The BBC announcement last week saw a new TV channel for Scotland, as we've heard, with integrated television news programme and major investments in network programming. This announcement is in response to audiences who have expressed that they want to see more of their lives reflected on BBC Scotland, with programmes such as The River based in the Scottish Borders. The BBC is well aware of the perception that BBC Scotland currently struggles to do this because of the fantastic Scottish-based content has sometimes been eclipsed by equal surrounding content. This new channel offers a distinct service that will allow Scottish content to stand alone and shine brightly. The Director General, Lord Hall, detailed to me that because the way this new channel has been funded, it has the opportunity and ability to take risks, to be at the forefront of Scottish content, edgy and groundbreaking in commissioning. In total, an additional £20 million will be invested into this new initiative that will broadcast every evening to educate and entertain and includes an hour-long news programme edited and presented from Scotland. The BBC have promised to create an increase in 80 jobs in journalism, spread right across the whole of the UK. I look forward to hearing from the BBC and discussing with them how these new roles will build on the existing BBC Scotland apprenticeship programme and link with the BBC's UK-wide journalism trainee scheme to ensure the best young talent from Scotland can grow their skills within this industry. Deputy Presiding Officer, this is a Scottish channel with 1,000 hours and 750 of those will be original. This is a huge step in the right direction and will offer something that Scotland has never seen before. It's a big commitment, both in ambition and financial terms, and one that will require a lot of hard work to make this happen. But I have full confidence, however, that this will be a success. And this success is promised to be shared. Last week, the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee heard from Ken Macquarie. As Lewis MacDonald says, how this service could cover the whole of Scotland, every region, every community, to ensure that every part of the country benefits from this investment. This objective is at the forefront of their minds. It is crucial to recognise that this isn't just a Scottish service independent of the wider BBC. Lord Hall has made it clear that it is a service that is fully supported by the whole of the BBC. For example, the hour-long news programme at 9 will build upon the already strong running of the 6:30 news programme, reporting Scotland. As Jackson Carlaw said, it is the most watched news programme in Scotland. The 9 o'clock news programme will benefit from the entire journalistic and editorial global and UK resources of the BBC. Significantly, the 9 p.m. slot will not compete with any other terrestrial news programmes and will offer an alternative to the usual drama on offer. And this will be news from a Scottish perspective with original Scottish journalism to bring viewers informed and insightful journalism. The new channel will also be available online and on iPlayer in HD in Scotland and across the UK. It is important that this digital service is fully available to viewers, especially socially and disadvantaged people and viewers living in rural areas. Incidentally, Ofcom's latest Connected Nations report indicates that only 46% of rural properties in Scotland currently have access to superfast broadband. We look forward to the Scottish Government's first phase of rollout of digital infrastructure, which aims to provide access to high-speed fibre broadband to Scottish premises by March 2018. Ready for the launch of the BBC's new channel. To conclude, I would like to close
with
the words of Ken Macquarie. In Scotland, there is now an opportunity for us to come together and let Thank you.
Can I just say at this point that that time will be taken off the party of people who run over because we really are tight for time. And may I have Rona Mackay to be followed by Neil Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The airwaves were buzzing last week with the news that Scotland will finally have a daily BBC channel from August next year. But I wonder, would the father of television, John Logie Baird, be rejoicing that 90 years on from his invention, we are where we are? Of course, the new channel's a step in the right direction and it's long overdue, and our Cabinet Secretary should be applauded for all her work in helping it come to fruition. As a former journalist, I welcome the fact that it will create 80 new posts for an hour-long news and current affairs programme with editorial control over content, and I agree with Lewis MacDonald's comments on this issue. It will also be a chance to showcase Scotland's amazing array of national talent in the arts and the media and encourage future generations to contribute to our rich culture. However, Presiding Officer, Scotland's new channel has been funded to the tune of £30 million, which falls well short of the proportionate share being spent in Northern Ireland and Wales. Last year, 55% of licence fee funds were spent on Scottish network content. By stark comparison, 95% of licence fee funds raised in Wales were spent in Wales, with the figure for Northern Ireland being 74%. Yes.
Rachel Hamill.
Would Ronan Mackay agree with me that including the investment, the new investment and the distribution costs, that this will rise to up to 80%?
Ronan Mackay.
I haven't figured that out, but all I can say is, would you welcome this channel being run on a shoestring? Because I don't think that's what we want. By stark comparison, 95% of licence fee funds raised in Wales were spent in Wales, with the figure for Northern Ireland being 74%. The Scottish Broadcasting Commission estimated in 2009 that a new channel would cost around £75 million. You do the maths. It's also worth noting that in Catalonia, with a population just larger than Scotland, the public broadcaster's annual budget is £293 million. It broadcasts 6 TV channels and 4 radio stations. Remember that the BBC raises £320 million from licence fees in Scotland, so come to your own conclusion. Evidently, we have some way to go, but I do hope this is the start of a flourishing broadcasting future in Scotland, and we should all wish it well. On the wider issue of Scotland's rich and incredible culture, to outline it in a 4-minute speech is not easy. Inventors who changed the world, such as doctors, scientists and engineers, actors, composers, film producers, comedians, musicians, and all the rest. But, Presiding Officer, I look back in anger when I think about what has been done to our Scottish culture over the decades. The lack of Scottish history taught during my time at school still saddens me. I learned more about the Battle of Hastings and Oliver Cromwell than I did about the Battle of Bannockburn or the Highland Clearances. Then there were the generations of children who were belted for not speaking the Queen's English. Can you imagine children being denied the right to speak in their mother tongue because it was too Scottish? Thankfully, that's all changing, and our beautiful Scots language, including Gaelic, is back on the school curriculum. However, the commitment of £1.2 million investment in BBC Alba, as my colleague Angus MacDonald outlined in portfolio questions earlier, falls short of the 10-hour per week commitment the channel needs to ensure it can build on its success. To conclude on an optimistic note, however, I'm delighted that the Scottish Government is investing in Ward Park Film Studios in Cumbernauld, home to the fantastic Outlander, and soon to produce the new Avengers film, Infinity. Presiding Officer, the reawakening of our culture has been hard fought, but I'm glad that we're at last making some progress with this new TV channel. The nation of Scotland has contributed so much to the world culturally, and it has so much more to give.
Neil Findlay, to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I think all of us have criticisms to make of the BBC, whether it be the schedule, programmes, licence fee, whatever. Your criticism of choice, the BBC is not short of critics. I have serious concerns about at times about some of the political coverage, but let me say, if we didn't have the BBC, then I fear what our TV would become. I would be appalled to see us go down the route of US TV with a series of adverts interspersed by low-grade garbage on many channels. Here, over the decades, the BBC has set the standard in drama with things like Boys from the Black Stuff, Play for Today, Tutti Frutti, and comedy, Porridge and Rabsy Nisbet, Still Game, children's shows like Grange Hill and Ballymore, and in sport with Sports Scene, The Open Golf, and the Olympics. I've probably just given away my viewing schedule there. But consistently, the BBC delivers high-quality programmes, excellent value, presenting and creativity. And whether the news output is from London, Cardiff, Belfast, Glasgow, or any of the regions, it is of high quality. I don't always agree with the content. I often think the reporters can be more establishment commentators than straight news reporters. but it's undeniable that BBC output has a positive impact on the quality of output from other channels. Of course, politically, the Tories would privatise the BBC in a heartbeat if they thought they could get away with it. But they know that public opinion would kill that stone dead, no matter Mr. Carlaw's previous wishes. Over the last 5 years, nationalists have used the BBC as a political whipping boy. Who can forget the demonstrations outside the BBC studios in 2014? And we've heard repeatedly that the burning issue in every household in Scotland isn't low pay, it's not the state of the NHS, social care, or the loss of thousands of council jobs and services. It's whether we can have a Scottish 6 o'clock news. Well, I have to say, not a single person has ever come to my surgery, nor sent me an email, nor wrote me a letter saying that life would just be so much better if only we had the Scottish 6 o'clock news. I wish members on the SNP benches, certainly.
Alistair Allen.
The member for giving way. Does he not consider that whether it's at 6 o'clock, at 9 o'clock, one of the benefits of having a Scottish news programme is to cover some of the very issues that he's talking about, that his constituents come to him, and so that his constituents are not deprived of that information?
Absolutely. Neil Findlay.
That's why I welcome the news that not only are we getting the 9 o'clock news, we're getting a whole channel. I thought he would be ecstatic about that. I just wish members on his benches were as exercised and angry about their government starving of local government, about health and educational equality or social or the social care crisis, as they were about a 6 o'clock news. But tell you this, I won't hold my breath. Now, we know traditional TV viewing has changed. We can watch TV live, playback, on demand, and across a whole range of platforms. Many people access STV News, BBC News already, along with many other news options. And figures show an increased amount of viewing falls outside the normal standard measurement because people are looking at it across many platforms. So if people are interested in consuming more Scottish news, then they will watch it when it's convenient for them. Presiding Officer, £20 million of new investment, not just in a news show, but in a whole channel, is excellent at a time when Scottish journalism desperately needs it. I've never seen the parliamentary press pack so happy for many years. Can I say... I would echo the NUJ who welcomed it as a shot in the arm.
Patrick Harvey, to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Mr. Findlay has just reminded me to declare an interest as a member of the NUJ, so I'll do that. Can I begin by saying the one thing that I found most disappointing about Jackson Carlaw's opening speech, and I think he knows what I'm going to say, he didn't manage to work in a single Doctor Who reference into an entire speech, and I expected better. I thought at least we'd be told that the Scottish independence movement was the enemy of the world, or a Scottish six would take us to the edge of destruction, but nothing. And I know Mr. Carlaw can do better than that. I do welcome his motion, though, and overwhelmingly, the bulk of it, I agree with very strongly. It welcomes the announcement from the BBC. It calls for additional, or for adequate resources, certainly, and it makes some serious points about the relationship between Creative Scotland, Scottish Enterprise and the Scottish Government, which, many of which echo some of the conclusions of the report into the creative industries in the last session of the Scottish Parliament through the Economy Committee that I know the Cabinet Secretary contributed to that discussion. And I can even agree with Jackson Carlaw's motion that the BBC's willingness and ability to adapt to the broadcasting needs of a devolved Scotland within the UK has been shown and is being shown by this announcement. I'm sure that he can understand that those of us who don't see that as the only constitutional future for Scotland would like to broaden the argument out somewhat. And I personally want to be sure that the BBC has a strong and a vibrant future regardless of the constitutional settlement that we eventually arrive at. And that's why I'm glad the SNP amendment doesn't go down their earlier route of calling for a Scottish broadcasting service for the breakup of the BBC. And I do hope that the SNP is moving away from that policy for the longer term. Because I think that even if Scotland was to vote for independence at some future point, the argument for retaining the BBC as a multi-nation broadcaster is a strong one. and would not only ensure a genuine inbuilt incentive for the corporation to take its different audiences and jurisdictions seriously, but would also act as a double lock protection for the principle of a public service broadcaster funded by the licence fee, protecting it against the kind of attacks that Mr. Finlay rightly said do happen from time to time from a range of different political perspectives. Those attacks, I think, need to be defended against. I grew up with my dad coming home every evening from his job as a film editor at the BBC. And I was instilled from an early age with a belief that even when the BBC is rightly subject to criticism in aspects of the way it's run, it is greater than the sum of its parts. And it will continue to provide an important service for the future if we protect that principle of a public service broadcaster paid for by the licence fee. In Scotland, we do need to make a case as well for a reasonable share of our licence fee being spent in Scotland. And I don't want to put a figure on that. I don't want to say that the BBC's announcement at the moment has gone far enough. I don't want to say where that needs to end up at. But it needs to be adequate to build up the screen industries in Scotland as well and regain some of the ground that we've lost over the years and over the decades in the level of screen production in Scotland. But I believe we can do that, Deputy Presiding Officer, without breaking up the biggest news gathering machine on the planet and without ever undervaluing or placing inadequate emphasis on our contribution to UK level production as well. Whether that's Doctor Who for Mr. Carlaw and myself, or the natural history output, or the wide range of drama and documentary output from the BBC. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Tavish Scott, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also want to thank Jackson Carlaw for bringing this debate to Parliament today, although I thought it was ever so slightly ungallant of him to begin by suggesting that John Nicholson was more important than Fiona Hislop. What I suppose slightly worries me about the new 9 p.m. Television news is that that may be the kind of item that becomes a regular on a news programme. We'll only have to encourage Brian Taylor and his colleagues not to so do. Fiona Hislop began by declaring, and she did rather declare this, that she expected the Nine to deliver. Well, I'm sure that is true of all of us, but I also want to make sure that that programme, and indeed the public sector broadcasters more generally, can deliver without any government interference, whether from Edinburgh or indeed from London, with less politicians phoning up to complain and with less social media abuse of journalists. If we could move forward in a new spirit with what was announced by Lord Hall last week, that would be to the benefit of news journalism in this country and at large. Lewis MacDonald mentioned public service broadcasting. Of course, the President of the United States has banned the BBC and indeed others from reporting things he doesn't like by excluding them from White House briefings. So journalism is under threat in that sense, and it's important to recognise the importance of editorial independence and to work darn hard on making sure that happens. I want to just pick up two points that were made by a number of colleagues across the chamber this afternoon, latterly by Patrick Harvey on the percentage of the licence fee. He made a reasonable point about a reasonable share. Now, Tony Hall actually did answer that question in the Culture Committee last week and gave some assurances on that. It will never be enough for some, but he explained at some length what had already been happened. But it is also important to remember that viewers in Scotland also benefit from the other aspects of the BBC that are shown, whether it be the World Service, whether it be the Olympics, the coverage of the Commonwealth Games, Match of the Day, which I know is not a great source of comfort to Joan McAlpine, but certainly to those of us who do are football fans, it's a big plus to the coverage the BBC produce. And also, as others have mentioned rightly, to the, if I must,
Joan McAlpine.
I just wanted to put on record that I don't have a down on a Match of the Day. I just was making the point in committee that £60 million is spent on Match of the Day, which is double that that's spent on the new channel. But I have absolutely nothing against Match of the Day, and I wanted to put that on record.
Tavish Scott.
I think that, as others have said, is £60 million, very well spent indeed. And if Joan McAlpine wants to have a debate about that in front of people in Scotland, I think those of us on the side of Match of the Day will probably win that. All but my delight in seeing Alan Shearer removed now and again from that programme would be considerable. But the important other point was on international news gathering. There are Scots all across the BBC, whether it be James Cook on the red carpet at the Oscars the other night or the other morning, if I saw him on Breakfast, to Quinton Somerville providing quite unbelievably strong news coverage from Iraq and in other areas of of that war-torn part of the world at this stage. That is a part of international news coverage and gathering that Lord Hall was very clear to make to mention last week in the context of what will now appear on BBC Scotland. Two other points. Firstly, this BBC Scotland only being a £32 million investment and Blair Jenkins' proposal some years back being £60 to £75 million. That omits the £10 million that Blair Jenkins also wanted to spend on setting the channel up in the first place, and the £10 million he also wanted to spend on the online and interactive parts of a new channel. It's important if you're going to compare apples with apples, you do so. And the figures are not quite as they've already been mentioned in this chamber. And finally, on commissioning, the Cabinet Secretary and others have made much of commissioning. I've seen Fiona Hislop on telly talking about this in recent days. The important point about commissioning is quality. Of course, there are excellent independent film companies and film organisations.
You must close, Mr. Scott.
Must always be based on quality.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, there's actually much to welcome in the announcement from last week, which committee members actually stated at the time. And I mean, I don't think anyone can disagree with the announcement of £30 million additional investment, as well as the additional 80 journalism jobs. And certainly with this increased investment in both the journalism and the wider production in Scotland, it is long overdue, as Rachel Hamilton had indicated in her comments when she stated about the biggest investment in Scotland in 20 years. Okay.
Neil Findlay.
But had the Cabinet Secretary or the First Minister last week said that this was terrible news, everyone in the SNP backbenchers would have been saying a completely different speech today. Or would you still have said that it was really good news?
Stuart McMillan.
I actually thought his first 2 minutes of his speech to Ellen was actually quite good, and then he resorted to type. I mean, certainly, I'm not sure if Mr. Findlay actually checked the official record from the European Committee, Culture Committee from last Thursday, when every SNP member actually welcomed this particular announcement. So I don't know what he's been reading. But certainly, Presiding Officer, this particular investment is very much welcomed, and the investment in journalism and other areas of broadcast that this development investment actually brings is much needed. Scotland's news landscape is not adequately evolved alongside devolution, and that was a point that was actually raised last week too. As we all know, the problem for the BBC hasn't been that devolution, it's not been with devolution, it's been that the news broadcast, sometimes from London, sometimes leads with stories that actually have got no direct relevance to Scotland. And that's also understandable. But the SNP, as has already been stated, has long called for a new TV channel for Scotland, which can make better use of the wealth of production and journalistic talent that Scotland actually has. The extra £90 million investment in 80 jobs and the prospect of more homegrown drama is also excellent news for Scottish broadcasting. And I agree with Tavish Scott in terms of about the quality, and it has to be about the quality of what's actually being presented. The investment goes to underline that Scotland has the talent and skills to produce an hour-long news and current affairs programme covering issues from home and also around the world. And of course, many journalists will actually want to work abroad or in London for network news, but actually, wouldn't it be tremendous if some felt as if they didn't need to leave Scotland to actually progress? Now, this new Scottish TV channel, it will be capable of nurturing the talent and also be truly reflective of Scotland's current diversity. And it also is that massive step in the right direction. Once again, as Rachel Hamilton commented upon, as did my colleague Rona Mackay. Now, the longer term test will come when the channel actually gets underway next year. And the BBC has now recognised that that Scotland is changing and also it needs to change too. And certainly, as the fact that with the Smith Commission recommendations, the fact that the BBC are laying the reports now in the Scottish Parliament, also coming to the Scottish Parliament, indicates that the BBC are also now willing to consider this aspect of the changing nature of devolution. Now, the success of the new channel and its investment will certainly depend upon how it's implemented and whether it can be delivered with the genuine ambition and innovation. And there are concerns. Legitimate concerns as to how far the £30 million of additional funding can actually go, but there's also the issue about BBC Alba. Now, the additional £1.2 million for BBC Alba is certainly welcome, but it still doesn't put the channel on a par with S4C in Wales, and that's a point I raised last week. Now, I'm conscious of time signing also, but the new programme, the news programme, the 9 till 10, if it doesn't establish itself quickly with the audience, then unfortunately the whole channel might not actually gain the full support of the public. But, Presiding Officer, there is huge potential in this announcement, and it's certainly exciting, and it's a vibrant broadcast opportunity time for Scotland. However, in 2018, people will be watching the new channel closely to see if it merits one simple test: do the programmes reflect Scotland as it really is? Thank you very much.
Oliver Mundell, to be followed by Joan McAlpin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to have the opportunity to speak in today's debate on a new BBC Scotland digital channel, not least because it affords me an early opportunity to pitch the commissioning of the Real Housewives of Dumfriesshire to BBC bosses. And with yourself in the chair today, it certainly does feel a bit like Dragon's Den in here. I hope you'll accept that comment in the light-hearted sense it's intended. But all joking aside, I believe this proposal is a once-in-a-generation opportunity to expand and enhance the range of television programming on offer. And I think it represents a real step change in the BBC's approach to the newfound realities of devolution, and will allow for a distinctive and culturally relevant programming across Scotland, bringing with it new jobs and helping ensure that we retain important skills here in Scotland, giving our young people and the next generation greater possibilities than ever before within the industry. And at the same time, it manages to ensure that viewers here in Scotland will have the maximum choice and continue to benefit from UK-wide news and television. I believe this announcement is all the more welcome and positive, and indeed remarkable, in the increasingly politicised climate in which the BBC has to operate. Sadly, despite the very robust mechanisms, we continue to see the impartiality of the service called into question. And most disappointingly of all, we frequently see accusations being made regarding the integrity of their journalists. And I therefore very much welcome within that context the bold approach the BBC have taken, and I believe that they've got the balance just about right. It's in that context, too, that I am disappointed but not surprised at the reaction we've seen from some in the SNP who continue to suggest that when it comes to television in Scotland, there's only one acceptable option, their own. I believe that this approach takes away and undermines the significant benefits this new channel will bring to our nation. And it's also why I'm dismayed that the Scottish Government felt the need to amend the motion in the name of Jackson Carlaw to make what I feel is a pretty petty point about its own view of the importance of the United Kingdom. I also think that calling into question the channel's funding before it's even had an opportunity to get up and running smacks of political opportunism. And for Patrick Harvey's benefit, I think if you listen to some in the SNP, they're almost suggesting that the new BBC Scotland channel would be the size of a TARDIS, with very, very small. But I actually think it will be like a TARDIS in reality, because this amount of money will allow for a massive expansion within the BBC here in Scotland of the programming that they have on offer. We've heard mention of my South of Scotland colleague Joan McAlpine's views on Match of the Day, and I understand that she's not saying that the programme should be pulled, but I think it's just the wrong type of argument to be making that somehow a new channel in Scotland should be benchmarked against a football programme that's broadcast across the whole of the UK. And it points to the fact that the Scottish Government and many within the SNP continue to miss the opportunities and the real arguments that we are considering. And I hope that now this announcement's been made, that all parties in this chamber will get behind the proposal and ensure that we see Scotland-wide coverage that captures the interests of all our communities, from the border regions to the islands. Thank you.
Mr. Mundell would do well to remember that dragons never forget. And I move to the last of the open speeches, Joan McAlpin.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I actually agree with much of what's in the Conservative motion. I've been sat on several committees of this Parliament, the Economy Committee, which looked at the Creative Industries, the current Culture Committee, and the previous Education Culture Committee, and they all did a lot of work in getting us to where we are, and that's why I actually agree about the issue of the screen agencies working together, Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland, and I absolutely welcome the work that the Cabinet Secretary's done in that regard to make that happen, and also what she's done in getting this really important aspect of the BBC Charter in place, which is the public purpose to sustain and grow creative industries in the nations and regions. That's really, really so important in terms of growing our creative industries, and it's a tribute to her and to the committees of this Parliament that we've got there. This issue about the Scottish Six, I supported the Scottish Six. The Conservatives say we need to move on from that, so I'm not quite sure why it's in the motion. We are all moving on from that. I actually think that the new channel presents, you know, a fantastic opportunity to move ahead and to get to where the creative industries are asking us to get to in terms of the spend in Scotland. The Director General of the BBC, when he was giving evidence to the committee last week, did agree that we're at a starting point with the new channel. So those who say that we're being churlish by raising the issue of funding, I think are missing that. It is a starting point, and the 80 new journalists are really, really welcome. I was really pleased to hear them say that there are actually going to be more jobs than that once the director of the new channel comes in place and quite rightly decides to him or herself what the shape of it's going to be. We'll see where the rest of the money is spent on new jobs. But you know, if you're funding original news to that extent, and you're also taking in the funding for the BBC opt-outs, you've got to ask where the rest of them. Where the rest of the funds are going to be met from, and comparing it to BBC Four is fair enough. It's one of my favourite channels on the BBC, but the BBC Four does rely on quite a lot of archive coverage from one of the best archives in the world, and I just think we need to keep a watching eye on that spend in terms of creative new programmes like drama, which are very, very expensive, but you know, I absolutely welcome it. And it's not just us that are making this point about funding, you know, it's the creative industries themselves. And I just wanted to read out a little bit of feedback that the committee got from one of the independent producers who has been campaigning for an increase in this spend in the licence fee, which is, I think anybody who's sat in any of those committees would recognise that this issue of the amount of licence fee that we get to spend is a real concern to the creative industries in Scotland. And this producer, after our evidence session last week, says, it's been a good couple of days, real positive change, but also clear-sighted cross-party pressure for a better still return on investment. Thank you for all you did today. So many of us are grateful to you and your committee for your engagement and the results delivered already, and I hope that the committee can keep the pressure on. So I would just say that to people who say that it's wrong for us to raise the issue of resources. It's really important to raise the issue of resources. And John McCormick, the head of the Screen Sector Leadership Group, has also raised that issue of licence fee spend in his report. And he is, of course, a former head of BBC Scotland. So this isn't just an SNP issue. I just wanted to finish off very quickly by saying that I totally support the BBC's efforts to influence the Westminster Digital Economy Bill, which is currently in the House of Lords. The BBC wants to ensure that electronic programming guides give prominence to public service channels, and that's supposed to happen just now, but I know previously through my efforts to get prominence for local TV that it doesn't work out in practice, and with a new channel coming on stream, it simply can't be allowed to happen that you know, that people are finding it difficult to find the new channel. It has to be right at the top of the programme guide, and I support that. Thank you.
We now move to the closing speeches. I call Alec Rowley. 4 minutes, please, Mr. Rowley.
Thank you. And closing for Labour, can I say that Jackson Carlaw, in fact, this has been a really good debate today and a good discussion. Jackson Carlaw spoke about John Nicholson's comments when this announcement was made. I had the unfortunate situation where I hadn't heard the announcement before I heard John Nicholson's comments, and I thought to myself, what have they announced? And so it was a great surprise to me and a welcome surprise when I actually heard the announcement. And whilst Mr. Nicholson perhaps has been put back in his box, sadly the SNP amendment would suggest that they aren't willing to embrace and welcome this opportunity. I note that Patrick Harvey said that even if he got his wish for an independent Scotland, he would not want to break up the BBC, and I think he's right and to say that. But unfortunately, I don't think the SNP are willing to come to that point. I've only got 4 minutes, sorry. So it's disappointing, but I think we need to look at where is the opportunity, how can we get the maximum benefits for Scotland right across the creative industries from this announcement. And that will be the important point going forward. Joan McAlpine makes a point that it is right to continue to argue for resources. And it was similar where Rona Mackay talked about the licensing fee. And I agree, we should continue to make the case for resources. Only wish Joan McAlpine and others wouldn't attack us when we keep making the case for local government resources that are being cut time and time and time again. But I agree that of course, you know, and when this channel's up and running, and if it needs more resources, we should be more than willing as a parliament to make the case for those resources. I think, as Lewis MacDonald says, the 80 new journalist post is very welcome for Scotland. This is a good thing. In a time where we have media empires like the Murdoch empire trying to go for world domination, if we didn't have a BBC, we would need to create a BBC in order to ensure unbiased reporting right across the world. So it's a good thing that we're going to get these journalists. And the idea of moving on from the Scottish Six, I actually think that we are getting something that is an even better opportunity for Scotland than would have been simply the Scottish Six. And therefore, it's not just about moving on, it's actually saying here is a real opportunity. We need to now embrace that opportunity, and we should also be looking at digital and other areas. The Cabinet Secretary, in response to the points that were being made for Jackson Carlaw about studio capacity, etc., run through very quickly a whole range of things that are happening, and I will take the time to read that. I couldn't quite follow at the speed that she was going at, but you know, it sounded like there was a lot of things happening there. The important thing, I think, that can be perhaps in summing up could be mentioned, is where is the overall strategy in Scotland? You know, I was in Northern Ireland and Derry in the summer, and I went along to the cinema and watched the film Bobby Sands, 66 Days, which is a really good film documentary. And at the end there, it said that it had been produced by BBC Northern Ireland. In Scotland, we had just a few months ago the independent production on BBC of The Council, which really highlighted what it's like every day for people working in local authorities delivering important services. So I agree with the point that we actually can produce programmes in Scotland, create opportunities in Scotland.
Must close,
and I hope that the government will grab this opportunity, invest and put in place a strategy to make the best of it.
I call Fiona Hislop. 5 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
I am glad that we're seeing changes from the BBC. I'm glad we've had the opportunity to debate this so quickly after the announcement. And I thank Jackson Carlaw for bringing the debate in that spirit. It is a result of years of hard work, debate and discussion, both publicly and I think also internally within the BBC, that's brought us to this moment. There now is a tangible opportunity for the BBC in Scotland to deliver more, to deliver better as a key driver in the creative growth and sustainability of our cultural sector, as Rona Mackay said, for the benefit of our economy, our society and our democracy. It needs the will of the BBC to deliver, and it also needs the will of our public bodies to deliver together strategically and in partnership to help that. But in many ways, the BBC are playing catch-up, and it is quite notable that the STV have already taken the lead for planning an hour-long Scotland at 7, an international and domestic news programme. And reflecting on Kate Forbes' intervention, in 18 months' time, we can watch news, BBC UK at 6, STV at 7, BBC Alba at 8, BBC Scotland at 9, and ITN at 10.
Jackson Carlaw.
The Cabinet Secretary knows the crucial difference is the BBC programme will be networked across the whole of Scotland. On Freeview, the STV programme will only be involved in the cities where it has actually achieved the city contract. So it won't be a nationally networked news programme on STV, but it will from the BBC.
Fiona Hislop.
In terms of content, in terms of what we can deliver, in terms of journalistic standards and opportunities to reflect a Scottish lens to Scotland, I think that the fact that the STV are doing what they're doing, they are to be congratulated. But I also think that in terms of this debate, some of the important themes that have been about the importance of public service broadcasting raised by a number of people and the quality that that means, the editorial independence that Tavish Scott mentioned and Lewis MacDonald is absolutely critical, and that's why it's in our amendment. But I also think that the EPG point that was made, and I think that's reflecting the point that Jackson Carlaw is saying, if we want quality news or indeed drama or indeed other content from broadcasting, it has to be accessible. And I think that's important that we take that forward as part of our ongoing, I think, scrutiny of what's going to be involved. I think maybe perhaps in this debate we haven't had as much time to think about commissioning. That's been a big issue for the previous committees of this Parliament. The £20 million of network commissioning additional for Scotland was welcome, but I think we've yet to pin down what that means, and I think Tony Hall has acknowledged that, as he did when I spoke to him about the fact that with this new channel, the spend of the licence fee in Scotland will be closer to 68%, and that's in response to what Rachel Hamilton was saying. We haven't talked about radio either. I think that there's an opportunity, as we've called for two stations, one speech and one music, and again, I think that would be welcomed. And the point that Lewis MacDonald made about BBC Alba, we've still got some journey to go. We've still got some details, I think, to come out from last week, but I think we should still press for that 10 hours of original production. I think that's going to be very important indeed. But that funding that's coming from the BBC to cover the £1.2 million of Gaelic programmes previously funded by BBC Alba is very welcome indeed. We have much, I think, to look forward to. I think there are great expectations both from the channel, but also I think from the wider sector. And I think the role of the independent production sector in Scotland is one that has been scrutinised by this chamber, and they have opportunities here both with the channel, but also I think with the new commissioning as well. But remember, in terms of the skills we have got great talents in Scotland. I think the fact we're going to have 80 new journalist jobs is very much to be welcomed. I think in terms of attracting and being able to sustain both film and high-end television, it is the skills of our talented crew that bring people here. And I think as part of the role of the BBC strategically, and it's something I've impressed with them in all the discussions I've had, they have a responsibility not just to take in and use the existing talent, they really have to help grow and develop strategically our creative industries in partnership. I've just received the Screen Leadership Group's report. Those of you who haven't read it, I recommend it particularly to Alec Rowley in his relation to film strategy. I think he'd find that particularly interesting. We'll respond more fully in due course. But that report has been produced by well-respected leaders in the industry, and it provides a considered direction for all our agency and the industry to follow, and we also bid the BBC to follow its recommendations also. Presiding Officer, the opportunities for the creative industries and the screen sector are strong, and together the public sector and the private industry interests can realise the ambitions of our sector, precisely as Patrick Harvey set out, to realise our full potential as a screen nation. So I urge members to act as they have done, collectively and consensually, and I hope that if they can support our amendment, we are taking forward the spirit of what I think this debate today has been about from all sides of the chamber.
Thank you. I call on Jamie Green to wind up.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst not current, I ought to declare an interest in today's debate in that I worked for over a decade in the television industry, both at the BBC and in the independent production sectors. When one thinks of culture, perhaps nothing is more ingrained in our country's fabric than the BBC. It is not just a landmark institution or an iconic brand, but those three squares are a world-renowned source of news. It is an entertainer, it is an informer and a producer. It brings us everything from the Olympics to Wimbledon, from angling to the archers, from Elgar to Eurovision. But evolution has seen it grow from the early days of analog black and white to the digital transformation, which today sees 290 million requests to iPlayer a month, or the 18.3 million downloads of stories from the CBBS Storytime app. It is devolution that is how the BBC has survived over many decades of increased commercial competition. And now we're in the latest chapter of this evolution, a brand new multi-platform, peak time, dedicated Scottish TV channel. Now, I would expect that a tailor-made BBC channel for Scotland would be unequivocally and warmly welcomed by all in this chamber, and I am pleased that there have been some very positive contributions today. But for some, more is never enough. I will address some of the critique later, but first I can perhaps focus on some of the positives. A number of members, including Rona Mackay and Stuart McMillan, welcomed one particular aspect of this, the 80 new jobs it would create, but did highlight that these posts should be spread across Scotland, and I think that's a fair point. My colleague Rachel Hamilton asks how these new roles will build on the existing BBC Scotland apprenticeship programme and how it will link with the BBC's UK-wide journalism trainee scheme, something which I'm sure the BBC will reflect on. We heard from the Cabinet Secretary who said that the Scottish Nine must deliver, and absolutely, I agree. The problem we have with the amendment is it pretty much removes any reference to the UK in our motion. Lewis MacDonald made a very valid point that we should judge this new announcement on its merits, not on the wider constitutional debate or indeed on old arguments about the BBC. So we're happy to support his amendment and that sentiment. Neil Findlay made a curious point about the privatisation of the BBC, but I think he failed to mention that it was actually a BBC renewed BBC charter under a Conservative government that enshrined a publicly funded public broadcast service through the licence fee model. Patrick Harvey showed a renewed sense of enthusiasm for the BBC, I thought, and he made a very curious point as well about retaining the BBC in this theoretic independent Scotland, but missed the point completely about how it would actually be funded. I found some interesting points came from Stuart McMillan about career opportunities that this new channel might create. In fact, I can say to the member that I was one of those people who headed to London for a career in TV, as there weren't such opportunities in Scotland at the time. Be happy to.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank Jeremy Green for taking the intervention, but that certainly was the point that I raised earlier on. You felt, well, so Mr. Green felt as if he had to go because there were a lack of opportunities in Scotland. The point I raised was that it would be good for people to feel as if they wanted to stay here because of the increased opportunities here in Scotland.
Jamie Green.
There's nothing there that I disagree with. Thank you for making that point. Some really good points were made about how the BBC should deliver on the promise that it made last week, and I've got no doubt that this Parliament will hold the BBC to account, but there are some logistical issues to resolve, for example, such as the matter of EPG PSB prominence, something which can really only be achieved through Ofcom regulation and surely is already causing the owners of various TV platforms to twitch nervously. Oliver Mundell pointed out that members who raised the, in my view, quite parochial argument around the portion of licence payer money raised in Scotland that is spent in Scotland are in fact missing the point entirely. The BBC raises £320 million in Scotland through licence fees, but a Scottish viewer listener has access to over £3.5 billion of BBC infrastructure and content, which includes £2.2 billion on TV, £600 million on radio, online, and so on. I could go on. In fact, 86% of all content consumed in Scotland is of UK-wide network content, because that is what consumers want. And I know it might be hard for some in this chamber to believe, but people at home right now in Scotland are not watching this chamber, they're watching Flog It on BBC One. And at 5:15, you'll be pleased to know that Pointless is coming on. And no, that isn't just another government debate on Brexit. The critics ask the BBC to respond to the needs and demands of a modern, devolved Scotland, and that is what they got. They asked for a Scottish Six, and they got a Scottish Channel. They asked for an hour of news, and they got 825 hours of content. They asked for more money for BBC Alba, they got a 20% increase in funding. They asked for more money for content, an extra £20 million into Scottish content. The reality is, presiding officer, is that as a family of nations, we collectively share resources and talent. And by doing so, consumers across the UK will benefit from that. In closing, I ask this chamber to unanimously and collectively welcome the news of this new BBC channel and support our motion today.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on the new BBC Scotland digital channel. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 4327 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4327.
Formally moved.
Thank you. And as no member has asked to speak against the motion, I'll put the question to the chamber. The question is that we agree motion 4327. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. I'd ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions 4328 and 4329 on the approval of SSIs.
Moved together.
Thank you. And they'll be put at decision time, to which we now come. Seven questions as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 4286.1 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville, which seeks to amend Motion 4286 in the name of Liz Smith on the abolition of the Scottish Funding Council Board, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a division and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 4286.1 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville is yes 62, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that motion 4286 in the name of Liz Smith on the abolition of the Scottish Funding Council Board be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 4286 in the name of Liz Smith is yes 63, no 62. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that Amendment 4287.3 in the name of Fiona Hislop, which seeks to amend motion 4287 in the name of Jackson Carlaw on the new BBC Scotland digital channel, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 4287.3 in the name of Fiona Hislop is yes 73, no 52. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that amendment 4287.4 in the name of Lewis MacDonald, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Jackson Carlaw, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that motion 4287 in the name of Jackson Carlaw, as amended on the new BBC Scotland digital channel, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that motion 4328 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the approval of an SSI be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The next question, or the final question, in fact, is that motion 4329 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the approval of an SSI be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. And that concludes decision time. We'll now move to a members' business debate in the name of Alexander Stewart. We'll just take a few moments for members to change seats.